Good afternoon. Welcome to Verde Exchange, and welcome to our panel on how Los Angeles is going to achieve zero waste. We have an extremely distinguished group on the panel today. I'll give a very quick introduction. To my immediate right is Heather Repenning. Is that right?
Yes.
Okay. And she's with the City of Los Angeles Board of Public Works. She's commissioner. She oversees the Bureau of Sanitation to ensure that the implementation of key trash and recycling programs, as well as serving as lead for the board on issues related to water in the LA River. I've asked them each to tell a little bit more about themselves as we start with our first question, so I won't continue to mangle their bios. To her right is Karen Coca, who is the diva of sanitation for Los Angeles. Is that the title? did I get that right?
She
can fill in the blanks on that too. And then to her right is Daniel Rafferty, who is the Assistant Deputy Director heading the Los Angeles County Department of Public Works Environmental Programs Division. My name's Bob Sipshin. I'm an editor with the California section of the Los Angeles Times. I've been there and in other capacities at the Times for a long time. I took a quick break and went up to Northern California to do some work with the Sierra Club. And so the purpose of this panel is to discuss LA's vision for a waste-free future at the nexus of sustainability, climate change, renewable energy, and waste management. The people here are in the position to see that that happens. And so I thought I'd just ask them by telling us a little bit about how we came to have this vision, how we came to set the goal for the city of Los Angeles of when we hope to achieve zero waste. And they're gonna start by telling a little bit more about themselves. So we'll start here with Heather.
We are the only full-time commission in the city of LA, and we oversee the Department of Public Works, which is comprised of the Bureaus of Sanitation, Engineering, Street Services, Contract Administration, and Street Lighting. I'm the liaison to Sanitation, which is obviously the biggest of all of those, and Sanitation manages all of our stormwater, wastewater, and solid resources for the city. And they're kind of the lead environmental agency, the Environmental Protection Agency for the city as well. We have incredible staff working in the department. Karen is one of those key people on this topic. I see our role as a board is to really keep the work of public works and its bureaus in alignment with the goals of the mayor and the city as a whole. We're very lucky at the city of LA to have a sustainability plan in place. So Mayor Garcetti, when he was first elected, hired a chief sustainability officer, and that office worked very hard for about a year to put a sustainability plan in place, which sets very clear goals for all of us. And it makes it quite easy to do our job because we know what we're supposed to be doing, and so we know if we have to push really hard to get there, then we're gonna push really hard because we're told to hit those goals. So for us, we're trying to get to 90% zero waste by 2025 and 95% by 2035. One of the key components in going from where we're at right now, which is I think around 74% diversion, meaning material that we're not sending to the landfill that we might otherwise send to the landfill. We just actually today signed contracts with private haulers who were awarded exclusive contracts as part of our franchise program for multifamily residential and commercial properties. So many of those properties currently have no level of recycling at all provided through the private industry. They're now all gonna have recycling. So that's gonna make a big dent. Another big dent as well that we're gonna be making is really looking at food and organic waste in the city. So we know what our goals are, and we have some very aggressive programs and projects in place to get there.
Okay, let me take you back a little bit to the question, though, and then we'll go on. Who is going to be in charge of making sure this happens? Is it the mayor? And if it's the mayor, how do you sustain that accountability over multiple tenures?
Sure. I mean, I mentioned the mayor's sustainability goals. I'm a mayoral appointee, but we actually also are fortunate to have the SWRP, the Solid Waste Integrated Resources Plan, which was a plan that is an environmental document that actually lays out our goals as a city. There were many, many stakeholder meetings that happened in the development of this plan. So this plan actually has the sign off, not just of the mayor, but of the city council as well, and many, many other people, environmental groups, et cetera. So we actually have a plan at the city of our solid waste program, which is very helpful. The mayor's goals are somewhat more aggressive because we have the 2035 goal as well. So we actually have an overall plan. So I would say on that front, we're accountable to both the mayor and the city council.
Okay, Karen.
Well, thank you for calling me a diva. My name's Karen Coca. I work for the Bureau of Sanitation in the city of Los Angeles, and we are the agency that is tasked with making the vision happen. So we're the boots on the ground. We're the we assist our elected and appointed officials with policy development, but then we get out there and do the work. So this is going to take a collaboration of everyone. We have to change consumer behavior. We have to change the way we do things. We have to get data, which is, we have to really revitalize an industry that is used to making loads of material disappear when they don't want it to be counted. And so there's a lot of things that we have to change. And we talked about the Zero Waste LA franchise system and moving that forward, and that's going to take a big dent out of it. The next real goal will be working with our existing customers, who are all of our residents, and trying to bring them up to the sustainability that we know that they can do. It's a big job, but we're up to the task.
Okay, thanks. Mr. Rafferty.
Yeah, Dan Lafferty, LA County Public Works. We've got a couple of different hats that we wear. For unincorporated county communities, we are the ones that haul the trash for those citizens and provide that trash service. But we're also responsible for the geographic county long-term planning for solid waste management and ensuring that we have adequate disposal capacity for the next 20 years or so. And much like the city, we also, our Board of Supervisors adopted a plan that we call the Roadmap to a Sustainable Waste Management Future. And it laid out for us very specific goals, including some intermediate milestones. We're currently at about 75% in terms of a diversion rate of things that are no longer making their way to landfills. By 2045, we have to be at a minimum of 95% diversion rate. So I don't know if that's necessarily an aggressive goal. I think, you know, as with any undertaking, there are certain low-hanging fruit that it's fairly simple to achieve, and then as you get further and further along, it gets more and more difficult. So the effort, I think, that when we get to 90%, which we're supposed to be at 2035, that 10-year period from 2035 to 2045 is truly going to be challenging in trying to make sure that we achieve those goals.
Thank you. So I'm going to assume that at least a couple people in the audience here, and I know the Verde Exchange audiences tend to be extremely sophisticated and knowledgeable, but I'm going to assume a couple people here are as ignorant on this subject as I am. And so let me just ask a couple other kind of simple questions here. What other agencies should we know about that are involved? We have the county and the city working together here. I understand this is a very extremely complex puzzle you're trying to solve. who else, is there anyone else that we really need to know about it that are key players in all this?
Well, all the other 87 cities and counties.
87 cities, yes.
Yeah, and I would also add, at the state level, CalRecycle, who tend to set the statewide standards for us, and making sure that we're hitting those goals as well as our own. So they're kind of a driver at the state level for us.
Okay. So the next thing I thought I'd do is just as we talk about how what we're doing to reach these goals, and you see, Karen, I'm already saying we because I get that we're all a part of this, but can you tell us a couple things that each of you are working on that kind of has you excited about the ability to attain the goal? I know that I have a feeling I know you're going to talk about these franchise districts, but maybe not. What are you excited about, Heather?
I think I will talk about those franchise districts. We just signed the contracts today. It's been many years in the making. You know, essentially, the way it works in LA, the city provides trash pickup, recycling, both blue and green bin services to all residential customers up to apartment buildings of 4 units. Anything over that is served by the private industry. Now, the private industry up until now has been, and all commercial properties as well, served by the private industry. Up until now, the private industry has been totally unregulated. And so, you know, the level of service has varied widely. The level of customer service has varied widely. The type of infrastructure that they're using and providing has varied widely. You know, the key thing for LA, we could not continue down a road where many, many of our properties have no recycling services provided at all. And so one of the key drivers in looking at our zero waste goals was how do we ensure that we have recycling provided at all of our apartment buildings, at all of our commercial properties. And so part of that was looking at regulating the private hauling industry. So what we did was we broke up the city into 11 districts, and we put out an RFP for each of those districts. And we awarded 7 contracts to 11 contracts to 7 different providers. And in engaging with us on one of those contracts, the companies now have diversion goals that they have to hit. So they have to provide recycling, definitely blue bin, and increasingly green bin and organics. They have to provide clean fuel vehicles, which we're already going to be reducing the number of trucks rolling through our city because we only have 1 truck rolling down each street per day. When it was unregulated, we had companies serving all over everywhere. We now have 1 truck per street per day, which is reducing greenhouse gas emissions. But in addition to that, they're going to be clean trucks. We're also providing a standard customer service the program is actually run through the city. So now when someone sees a dumpster that's overflowing, they're going to call the city. It's going to be monitored. And so the street level infrastructure of our waste hauling is going to be a lot cleaner and a lot, I think, just better. We are also going to be making sure that a basic level of worker protections is enforced in the industry. I mean, it's a very physical labor that's performed in hauling waste, in sorting recyclables, and prior to our work in regulating the industry, often safety conditions were not being met. So there are a number of really important environmental goals, livability goals that we're meeting through this program. We're also going to be providing 1 standard rate across the city. So there's an equitable type of rating system that's going to be taking place. The City Council voted on the contracts in December. They were executed today. Karen and her team are working on implementing the program starting on July 1st. The actual transition of accounts, the formal transition will begin, and all of the accounts will be transitioned over by the end of this year. So starting on January 1st of next year, we're going to have citywide recycling. And that's really exciting.
What's a ballpark figure for the value of all those contracts?
$3 billion over 10 years.
Yikes. Okay, Karen?
Well, to expand a little on what Commissioner Repeni is talking about, you know, it's not often that you're given the ability in your career to just do what you think is best. And I was fortunate enough to lead on the RFP development. I spent a year in negotiations when I was on lockdown, and I wasn't able to talk to anyone. But what we were able to do is really revamp what's happening out there. For example, the haulers are required to partner with reuse organizations, and partner means monetary. If you think about it, if you're a waste hauler, you want it to go in the bin, you want to take it to your facility, and that way you get the most money. Well, we're turning that upside down. We're putting reuse and food rescue first, along with requiring that every single business, every single multifamily complex get education, they get a waste assessment, they have somebody to help them. And so there's a minimum level of staffing that they have to have throughout the contract. Again, not necessarily in a waste hauler's wheelhouse, but they have to learn to become service providers and take care of their customers. And many of the small waste haulers, especially those that we included in this contract, they already do that because that's how they compete with the big guys. So we're taking on a lot of their customer service and benefits that they have. There's also a requirement that they fund community benefits. We want them to connect with their neighborhoods and work within their neighborhoods. And so I have to say that working on this and then the implementing of it throughout this year is going to be, for me, a chance to see a six-year design come to fruition, and we'll all see if it works together.
Excellent. Another simple question, are these new contracts displacing any public workers, or is this these?
No, this is an area that's always been a private service model. They will take over all of the customers that are currently served under our permit system, which, as Commissioner Repeni mentioned, is unregulated right now. They simply get a operating permit, pay some fees, and they're allowed to operate. So this is going to change the nature of how they operate in our city.
Good. Daniel?
Yeah. So I mentioned our roadmap previously, and although it does lay out targets and milestones, it also does lay out strategies that we need to be exploring in terms of achieving those goals. And one of the bigger ones is organics management. In LA County, again, as a geographic county, we dispose of a little over 9 million tons of refuse each year. And of that number, roughly a third, a little over 2 million, are organics. And it's a big challenge simply because we don't currently have the mindset or the processes and infrastructure to divert those organics. But there's a great opportunity. You know, Karen talked about food rescue. And we heard yesterday Supervisor Ridley Thomas talking about the homeless issues that both the city and the county are facing. And so here we have what we are currently is a waste stream that is actually an opportunity for us to reduce the amount of garbage that's going into the landfills and provide food for those people who are unfortunate enough not to be able to afford it on their own. And so, you know, the county is working towards that. Our health department, which is the health officer for most of the cities within the county, they're currently drafting kind of the protocols of what would need to be in place to allow those diversions to occur. Because it's one thing to divert it out of landfills, but you certainly don't want to divert tainted food to the homeless. And making sure that we're doing that in a safe way is very important. So I see, in terms of sort of the near term, resolving that issue and moving that particular program forward is just being an incredible win for the region as a whole.
Good. I was surprised to see on some of the web materials that I was looking at that there are actually four bins, and I don't know if this is city or county too, but there are actually four bins. And I've got three of them, but I don't have the one that some in the audience might think a journalist most needs, which is the brown bin, which, as it's advertised on the waste, on the thing, is for horse manure. Is that, we actually have a bin just for horse manure in LA?
Yes, we have actually a couple hundred customers that own horses. Some of them are stables, so they have quite a number of horses. Mm-hmm. And so we actually collect and recycle that material.
Goes back into the organics. Okay, so I thought that I suspect some of the people in the audience here are here not just as committed public citizens wanting to recycle better, but perhaps have a bit of self-interest. And I thought I'd ask the panel here to, Justin, maybe starting with you, Daniel, and working this way this time, what are the opportunities that you see? I mean, when Heather talks about these new franchise zones, I think that's obvious there's opportunity there. What else are we seeing that might interest the folks in the audience?
Well, certainly for us to get to the goals that we've set for ourselves, we need to have much better infrastructure than we currently have. The processing facilities that are necessary for us to take what is currently in our waste stream and make some sort of reuse, some sort of commercially viable product, simply don't exist at the levels that we're going to need in order to achieve those goals. And I certainly see a huge role for the private sector in partnering with government or even on their own, identifying those opportunities and creating those sorts of facilities. I do think that from my perspective at least, the public-private partnership approach, where certainly government can help, if nothing else, with permitting aspects and trying to work with the jurisdictions where these facilities might be located. I think, too, that there's opportunities to leverage existing public land where it may be possible to locate some of these facilities. And finally, depending on how things are structured, may even be an opportunity for some cost sharing to try to jumpstart these facilities and get them in. When you look at the timelines, you know, it may sound like it's pretty far out there, but if you think about the lead time that it takes for some of these facilities to get permitted, to design, and to build, we're really up against the clock. And so I see there's a great opportunity, I think, for the public sector, for the private sector, to help us in that respect.
Well, Daniel, you'll be happy to know that as part of our franchise contracts, there's going to be an investment of over $200 million in new and improved infrastructure. We're actually, when we put these contracts together, we decided that we wouldn't let existing facilities go, that we would actually, our standards would be much higher than they were in the 80s when they built a lot of these old transfer stations. That, believe it or not, they're only like three sides. We require full enclosure. We require that they have air handling and other environmental controls in place. And so the waste haulers as a group are going to invest about $220 million over the next 5 years into putting their facilities together. And so we're happy to be part of that solution. I would say as far as opportunities, in my shop is also the Green Business Program. So we have the city's green business certification. It includes green lodging and green arts program. With that, actually, the green arts program is unique. It's the only one that exists because you deal with arts people in a different way and their facilities. But we need assessors. Just as part of the franchise contracts, the haulers have to add about 240 staff that will do nothing but be out in the field, perform outreach education, waste assessments, help the customers. So that's a growth. In fact, the haulers are hiring as fast as they can, anybody that they can train. Also, through the certification programs, you've got people that go out and do energy, water audits, and waste assessments, which is what the basis of a green business is. And those folks, as soon as our our sub, who is the LA Community College District, the minute they get their people trained, they get hired away by companies who want sustainability managers. So I think that is a huge growth area right now, and it really will be continue to grow in the future as far as employment goes.
Heather?
In addition to just looking at the waste hauling industry as an area for potential workforce development programs, we've been looking at opportunities to kind of diversify who's involved. I know Karen and I are both looking to get more women involved, minority businesses as well. I actually think that there's a lot of innovation potential in looking at reuse and recycling markets. So really looking at all of the outputs of our city and how we can find the best value for all of them. You know, it's unfortunate that a lot of our plastic bottles we have to ship overseas to China to get recycled. It's a marketplace that we don't control. We don't control the value of. And it's certainly not very green for us to have to ship things that far. I think for us to really look at how we can develop markets here in California for reuse of some of these end products, I think could be incredible for our local economy. Everything has a value. It's finding that maximum value and really using it. So, I mean, as we look at how we're gonna handle our food waste and our organics in the city of LA, you know, one of the things that we're contemplating is putting it into our digesters that we're building out at our wastewater treatment plant at Hyperion. One of the outcomes from that would be that we would be generating renewable energy. Currently, we're sending a lot of that to the landfill. So instead of generating methane, we're now creating renewable energy from it. We're also looking at whether, you know, we want to make sure that a certain amount is actually going instead to composting, because composting potentially is environmentally better. You can actually reuse it as opposed to having to send it with our biosolids out to our farm in Kern County. But all of these different ways of recycling have some sort of value created at the end, and I think really to look at how we can use those end products here locally so that we're not dependent on unstable foreign markets.
Okay, I think the next question I had dovetails with that one a little bit, in that I'm wondering if you would all care to offer some ideas on what fields or disciplines or areas of study for some of the younger people in the audience, or maybe some of the parents who want their kids to have paying jobs. What would you be studying if you were a young person who had come to this seminar and suddenly had this epiphany that, yes, solid waste management will be my life's goal, you know, solving that problem? The landscape is changing even as you're moving towards this goal. I mean, I have to think that with these franchise districts, with the density of Los Angeles growing so quickly, that the way that business is done is different. And that has to be the case across the board with Amazon filling our, I don't know about everyone else here, but I have sort of a multi-generational home where our recycling bin, thanks to Amazon, is filling much more quickly than it would. How do you adjust for this? What kind of fields would you suggest people study? We can start with you again, Heather, if you want.
Sure. I mean, we've talked a little bit about organic and food waste, but I think it's really the next frontier. I think 18% of what we're sending to the landfill right now is food. A higher percentage of what we send to the landfill is organic in some way, I think around 30%. It absolutely is material that has a value. It should not be sitting in a landfill. And so really getting creative about ways to keep it out of the landfill, including, as Dan mentioned, you know, food recovery programs. We have a lot of homeless and poor people in LA, people that don't have access to proper nutrition. How do we make sure that we are not wasting so much fresh, edible food here in LA when we have programs like Uber that can quickly connect a car to someone who needs a car? Why can't we connect, you know, boxes of produce to community centers or homeless shelters that would like to provide residents with nutritious food. In addition, looking at you know, local distributed composting programs. We don't have land here to do big composting. In LA, we'd have to send a lot of stuff, again, on a truck to someplace fairly far away to do large composting programs, but can we do neighborhood scale composting so that residents have access to locations in their neighborhood community gardens or parks where if they want to recycle their food, they can go there and we can turn it into something that's useful for the neighbors. That's an area that gets me really excited.
So is that studying chemistry or environmental planning or urban and regional planning or all of the above? I mean, it seems like anyone, you need help from all directions, it sounds like.
My background is in comparative literature, so I don't know. But I think it's really about connecting people to people in a lot of ways. I mean, I think it's really about kind of just establishing a smart human network here in LA that allows us to keep things here instead of sending them elsewhere to be used or disposed of.
Okay, Karen.
Well, the jobs that I mentioned previously, they actually teach those at the community college level. So it is an opportunity for folks that maybe can't go to a four-year or don't have the time because they have another life, that an opportunity. But I would say that if I had the opportunity to steer my kids and good luck with that, once, you know, once they get a phone, forget it, is technology. I mean, what we need now and what I see is equipment processes that are smart, that adjust themselves. Some of these machines are amazing. So it would be equipment design and processes. And I would say the massive amounts of data that we can gather and use, but we need somebody to build those systems. I would say that would continue to always be people that design apps. We need apps for people to optimize their lives so that they use less and they buy less crap that they end up throwing away. So I would say those are the areas where the growth is exponential, and it's certainly something that we need. And I welcome the millennials who are connected, because every time my phone doesn't work, I hand it to one of my kids and have them fix it for me. So we do, I see that as an area where the growth is just unmatched.
Okay. Yeah, and Daniel? I kind of echo what Karen had said. I think, you know, the what's called STEM, the science, technology, and engineering and mathematics fields are gonna be key for us to be able to achieve the goals that we've set for ourselves. You know, the piece of technology that we need to separate out that last 5% and make something worthwhile has yet to be developed. And we're gonna need it when the time comes. You know, that last push to get that last bit of the waste stream converted to something worthwhile is going to take a lot of innovation. You know, as part of that is, as with almost every problem that we confront, there's a kind of a multitude of issues that are correlative to that. And so certainly entrepreneurs and finance people who understand, you know, what it takes to get something to market, that then we would be available to us to make use of. But I would say certainly for the short term and for as far out as I can see, technology, and I did have the opportunity to try to persuade my kids, and not a single one of them ended up as an engineer. I tried my best, but they were not having it, so.
Good. So one other question now gets sort of to the timelines you've talked about. I told the panelists that for some reason when I was in high school, I was appointed to the San Bernardino County Junior Board of Supervisors, and we went out to the local landfill and we decided that the project we would take on as our own was solving the solid waste management problem. And we didn't do it. So I'm not too upset with these folks for not having done it yet, but I do kind of wonder that, I was in high school quite a while ago, what's taking so long? Why is this taking so long? And so I thought I'd actually ask, maybe you could talk openly about what a couple of the key challenges are. What is keeping this incredibly difficult problem from being solved more quickly?
I think we've mentioned them, at least in passing. To me, there's three what I would call substantial challenges that we need to meet. One is behavioral change. You know, we've gotten people, for the most part, used to the idea of recycling beverage containers. You know, I've been married now for about four and a half years, and my wife still, to this day, you know, when I pull out the drawer with their trash, I'm pulling, you know, the paper towel tube and sticking that in the recycle bin, and pulling out the plastic wrapper and putting that in the recycle bin. So even though there's been all of this effort to try to get people to recycle, there's still a lot of work that needs to be done. And we talk about the next step. If we're doing source separation for organics, for example, how do we get people to continuously do that? You know, that there's a separate bin that you've got to put all of that organic material in for us to be successful. And then we've talked about the infrastructure that needs to be built in order for us to be able to do the kind of sorting that needs to be done. And lastly, we talked a little bit about the market forces. You know, we may be able to produce some end product, but we've also got to make sure that there's a market for that end product when we're done with it. And I think those are all significant challenges where there's a lot of work that needs to be done in order for us to get to the point where we're going to be successful.
Good work, Daniel. That's what I do, too. I blame my wife when something yeah. doesn't go fast.
She wouldn't be happy if I shared that, I'm sure. But
I would make it a little more personal. We're in an instant gratification society. People don't want to be inconvenienced by having to empty out their beverage container and put it in the proper receptacle because they're in too much of a hurry to go do whatever it is that they're going to do. And yes, I do that in my household with everybody except my husband, who is the only one who's been clearly properly trained. But but my kids, if they're connected, they're busy, they don't think. So it's a thoughtless and almost a careless attitude. Not everybody is an environmental champion. So we have to find a way to connect with people that are not environmental champions and get them to do it. And I think that's the biggest challenge that we have.
Okay, and Heather?
I would say there's too much packaging. You know, it seems like the more we recycle, the more people put packaging around things that really don't need it. And so, I mean, I would love to see us work. I mean, we have a lot of work to do, as Dan mentioned, in terms of educating people on how to increase their recycling. But I think that we have a lot to do in terms of educating manufacturers on how to decrease their packaging. As you mentioned, Bob, you know, one of the great steps forward of modern times is that we can have things brought to our house, but then we just end up with all these boxes. So I think that that's one of the big challenges.
It's pretty amazing. Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay, good. Thanks. I think that we are at the point now where we're going to take some questions from the audience. We have a few more minutes. Pardon? No. Okay. You raised. Oh, okay. Yes. I think it's question time. I've got a few more too, but I'll let the audience go first and go ahead. Is that for the whole panel? Yeah. And if I got it right, you know, how about communications? If you want people to become better environmental stewards, you need to help them find their way to that path, right? Is that essentially it? How are you going to do that?
Do all plastic, but you can do compost stuff into
Right.
Or into the food, if a plastic cup you cannot recycle it, or a plastic cup can't compost it, or can you throw meat into it, or can you throw fish into it? All those kind of questions will be coming up as the conversation shifts, like, oh, it's open to everything.
Well, okay. I think that, you know, one of the guiding principles that I work under and I have for, well, since I showed up in sanitation 25 years ago, is that we have to have a consistency of messaging. We have to have consistency of practice. And so at that time, there were no recycling programs at LAUSD. There were, I think they did grass cycling. They left the clippings on the lawns. We did have our curbside program. We had just rolled out the blue bin, right? So what we started was a pilot with LAUSD. We taught the kids. The kids would go home and nag their parents. We get better recycling results, and we get less contamination. So we went through that process. LAUSD is now has blue bins and the same blue bin materials collected in all the schools. So this is the natural next step. And the idea is to keep it consistent. You see a blue bin, it takes the same materials no matter where you are in the city of Los Angeles. And that, I think, will help because everybody's confused about what goes in the blue bin. And we want to make it simpler, but we also want to make it consistent so that we don't say yes here, no there. And I think that that's a big part of getting over that hump, really. And then speaking to people at their neighborhoods, in their language, and in their cultural place as well.
Daniel or Heather, anything to add there? Okay, another question? Right there, your hand's been up for a while. Heather, did you want to take that one?
Well, one thing, I don't think this is the complete answer to your question, but one of the things that gives me hope for all of us is the plastic bag ban in LA, which recently passed statewide. When was it first implemented?
It was about 4 years ago.
So, you know, it was a big fight to ban these plastic bags. We had a lot of folks opposing the ban from, you know, the petroleum industry, the plastics industry, et cetera, from grocery stores that couldn't see any other way of doing things. And we did it. And now people go to the store, and a lot of people who never did this before bring their recyclable bags. And they're not environmentalists. They just don't want to pay the 10 cents. 10 cents is not a lot of money, but, you know, it's a driver. It's been enough of a driver to, I don't have the numbers on it, but I know at least in terms of what we're getting in our blue bins from plastic bags, I mean, the difference is night and day. What's ending up in the LA River and ending up in our ocean is night and day in terms of plastic bags. A major behavioral change, and it turns out it really was not a big deal. So I think that there is,
I would also add that, you know, one of the strategies that we have in our roadmap is extended producer responsibility. That's a very difficult proposition, simply because, as you noted, the weight on the other side is so big. But like the plastic bag ban, it started locally. You know, the cities and the county began that effort long before the state ban came into play. And I think that's kind of the approach that needs to be taken. that when you recognize who it is that needs to be held accountable on the long term of things, that if you can create at the local level the kind of ordinances that make it clear that you're expecting them to come in and clean up the mess when they're done, you know, that's where this needs to go eventually. And as has happened, as that catches on, municipality to county, it works its way up to the state level and eventually, hopefully, the federal level.
Yeah, does anyone have any metrics just on cardboard since Amazon became so popular? How much cardboard recycling has increased? It's got to be enormous.
I know it is at my house, like yours. Yeah. My blue bin is full of cartons. Right.
I think you're next.
Go? Okay. So organics, yes, they can't meet their disposal reduction goals because we didn't do diversion rate. Diversion rate can be calculated many different ways. What we said to the haulers was, this is your area, this is how much goes to the landfill from your area, you have to reduce it by 65% by 2025. And so it's a combination of recycling to the maximum extent, and then they have to deal with the organics. Basically, the organics is not a one-stop shop where there's one technology or one way to handle it. It's messy, it smells, it's wet. You have to get it out of areas that are populated to manage it properly. It is something that will continue to be a challenge, but they are putting a lot of infrastructure in. So there's a combination of composting for the materials they can, the haulers that under our contract. So part of the goal, part of the strategies include food rescue at the front, trying to get them to buy less, so you have less in the bins. But once it gets in the bins, then it's a combination of composting, anaerobic digestion, aerobic digestion. There's a dry digestion facility, which I'm sorry, I'm throwing all this stuff out. And at the end, if there's materials like bits of plastic, bits of paper, waste to energy is a part of that solution as well. Yes, there is material in the city that has gone to waste to energy since 1987.
Okay, so I must have missed a subtle signal here because I've now gotten a very overt signal. The door's been thrown open, and then my reminder did something like this and ran off. So I think I think those of you who don't care enough about the earth to stay and ask more questions are welcome now to leave and go to cocktail hour, but we'll be up here to continue. Why don't you? I actually think they've encouraging us to end this session, but if anyone wants to come up to the front and continue talking, I suspect the panelists will be welcome, will be amenable to doing that. Thank you, everyone.